Hello, welcome to Spotlight. I'm Fran Pellegrino. Today my guest is cabaret performer Richard Holbrook. Welcome, Richard. I'm so happy to see you, and you're happy and healthy.
Well, thank you, Fran.
After your journey.
Thank you, Fran. It's great to be here. It's wonderful to see you again. And I'm so grateful to you for letting me tell the story of my journey so I can maybe inspire other people going through difficult times and difficult diseases as well.
Yes, that's foremost in our show today. And then we're going to talk about your performing. And you'll see some video of Richard when he came back after his illness. So let's hear how you discovered your cancer of the jaw and your journey.
it started in the summer of 2013. I was about to do my Fred Astaire show again. I had done it in 2003. I was going to do it at Don't Tell Mama in Manhattan. And I was scheduled to be on your show, in fact, at that time, and to promote it. And in late August, I was diagnosed with single cell carcinoma, and I thought it was a canker sore that wouldn't go away. You see, I had two teeth that were extracted previously, and instead of the gum covering the holes growing back, a lump formed on top of the gum, and I thought it was a canker sore. But I got concerned, so
after having the teeth extracted, the lump formed?
Yes.
And it didn't go away.
And I went to an oral surgeon, and he said, this looks very suspicious. So he examined it, and he came up with the diagnosis that it was a low-grade malignancy that needed to come out immediately. So then I went to an otolaryngologist at Columbia Presbyterian, and he confirmed that it was single-cell carcinoma, and it needed to come out. So I had to cancel my Fred Astaire show. I had to leave my job temporarily. And with the help and the love and support of my family, I went down to Atlanta, Georgia, to Emory University Hospital, because that's where the bulk of my family lives. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't so much, well, the surgery was important, but the aftercare was important. And so I was examined by the surgeons down there. And by the time I got down there on September 10th, the tumor had spread to the jawbone, and the surgeon said the jaw has got to go.
And this started in, you discovered
August.
August. And by September.
September, yeah.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
Very fast.
Yes, and
well,
I was
luckily you went to the right people and was diagnosed. That's why early detection.
Early detection. It's important. Well, the thing is, I even said to them, well, since it spread so quickly, do you think we need to do the surgery right away? And they said, no, it's going to be fine. We'll put you on as having the surgery on October 1st. And so on October 1st, I had it. It was a 13-hour surgery where they removed the left side of my jaw and replaced it with the fibula of my left leg. And I was in the hospital for 9 days, and I was intubated. I couldn't communicate. I could only write illegibly on a tablet with a magic marker, and it was so frustrating because my sister would say, "Well, what's wrong? Are you in discomfort?" And I couldn't tell her. And to this day, I have the utmost respect and compassion for stroke victims and people who can't communicate.
Right.
Then the tube came out, and they put in a tracheostomy. And a feeding tube, and I went home.
Now you still can't speak.
And I was able to speak after they took out the intubation. I was able to speak, but I had to relearn really how to speak and to chew and to swallow. So I had to do exercises as well. But I got home and they had put a feeding tube in, so I really had no way of drinking liquids or chewing and eating solid food for a long time, for a couple of months now. And so I went through 6 weeks of radiation and 12 weeks of herbal chemotherapy where I didn't lose my hair and I didn't get sick.
Herbal? On that, just a little bit.
Yeah, they weren't going to give me chemotherapy. They weren't going to give me chemotherapy to begin with, and they decided that they were just going to do radiation, and they decided that since it was new, they would try it out and see if it worked, and it did, And the only thing was with the radiation, the only side effect I had was being tired.
Yes.
But around Thanksgiving time, which was like 6 weeks later, I was able to make my own pureed Thanksgiving dinner. And by Christmas, right before Christmas, the tracheostomy was taken out, and so was the feeding tube. So I was able to eat and chew solid food by then. So my recovery was quite rapid, and the doctors and surgeons were a little concerned because they weren't sure whether or not I would be able to sing for at least a while, a good year or so. But I said no, I've got to get back, and I was determined to be.
Did you have that determination from day one?
Yes.
That's good. So your eye was on the prize.
Yes, absolutely.
All the time.
Absolutely.
That helps too, don't you think?
Yeah.
To have a purpose, to know that you have this thing you're coming back to. Or
yeah. Well,
you have a desire to do again.
I had been on a roll because I had just done 5 years with the Burt and Lane Show, and I had just been nominated for a MAC Award as Best Male Vocalist the spring of 2013. Yes. And when I got diagnosed in the summertime, I wanted to say, oh, please, God, don't do this. Please, I'm on a roll. Don't stop me now. I said no, I've got things to do. My mother, that's what my mother said when she had cancer. She said she refused to admit defeat. She said, I have things to do. And I was the same way. And interestingly, my brother died of oral cancer the year before I was diagnosed. And I kept the diagnosis from my family for a good week. I was in a state of denial, but I kept it from them because I said, I can't put my family through this again. Mm-hmm. So I was going to go through it alone with my friends in New York and not have to worry my family about it. Well, I needed to get my family involved, and thank goodness they were there. I come from a big family, and some family members are closer than others, but in this respect, everybody rallied around me. Everybody was there for me. They took me to my appointments. They helped me do my exercises. They took care of me. And that's what I mean. It's so important, the aftercare, because you need, when you have to go for the chemotherapy appointments and the radiation appointments, you need somebody with you. You need advocates. And my four sisters, especially, were my advocates. I mean, they were my guardian angels. And
just making appointments and doing the things that we're that we take for granted every day are very difficult when you're feeling terrible from your radiation, and like you said, it's very tiring.
Yeah. Well,
your chemo is even
it's exhausting. But right before I got my the day that I got my tracheostomy taken out, the surgeon said, do a falsetto. So I did a falsetto, and and he said, I am so proud of you. You have done a whole 180 degree turn, because like I said, they weren't sure whether or not I'd be able to sing for a while, if at all. And so in January they started talking about me going back to New York, and in February of 2014 I went back to New York, resumed my life, resumed my job, and started singing in late spring. And the following October 2013, I was supposed to do the Fred Astaire show. October 2014, I did the Fred Astaire show at Don't Tell Mama. And for the first time, I was invited to sing at the New York Mabel Mercer Cabaret Convention in Rose Hall at Jazz at Lincoln Center.
Oh, okay.
And so I've been singing ever since. And recently, I have done a cabaret tribute to the composer Richard Rodgers. It's called Richard Holbrook, Richard Sings Rodgers with a Lot of Heart. H-E-A-R-T, which is a play on Larry Hart, so.
Yeah.
And it's tells Richard Rodgers' life story, not only containing songs that he wrote with Larry Hart, but also with Oscar Hammerstein and Stephen Sondheim. And one of the things about Richard Rodgers that was interesting, and I didn't realize it until I did research on him, was I knew he had a laryngectomy. I knew he had a laryngectomy towards the end of his life, and he could only speak with a whisper. But in doing more research on him, I realized that in 1955, just before his musical Pipe Dream was to open on Broadway, He was diagnosed with cancer of the jaw and underwent surgery. Mm-hmm. And within weeks, he was back at rehearsals right before Pipe Dream opened. He was so determined to continue his passion for writing music for the theater. And that's what I shared with him. I shared such an affinity with this man, not only with his music, but the fact that he was so determined to get back into the swing of it. And with me, I was so determined to get back into singing the Great American Songbook that I was back singing after only several months.
Well, that's what I wanted to you to elaborate a little bit on. When you first started, the first song you sang, I mean, did the notes come out? I mean, like, were you happy when you when you saw that you could? So from day one, when you started to sing again with your accompanist, I guess.
Well, it was a little...
So you must have been elated
that it was there,
though you kind of probably sang at home, but...
It's interesting because the first time I worked with Tom Nelson, my pianist, after I got back, I equate it with like scraping gravel on a driveway because it was, you're dealing with a muscle and you had a foreign object in there, like a tracheostomy, and you've got to get it back into shape. But I managed to get it back into shape, and that summer I sang at the National Council of Jewish Women. I did a prelude to my Rodgers show just to give me some confidence. And it went very, very well, and I was able to get back into singing again. And it took a while. My range had been somewhat limited, but I had to kind of keep stretching my vocal cords and my range to where I got it back to where it was before the surgery. So
sure, the vocal cords have probably been beat up, you say, with the tracheotomy and everything,
and also the radiation too,
the radiation
scar
affects
tissue
it as well.
And
scar tissue, that's right.
And
that's
so
that's the worst if you're prone to scar tissue builds up. Yeah,
but it didn't. Wow. But the nice thing was, right after my surgery, it started out as a stage 4. After my surgery, the doctors came back and said to me, it went to a stage 3, curable. And it didn't touch my lymph nodes, tongue, or vocal cords. So I was able to sing again. Yeah. And as you can see, like the lower part of my mouth, I'm missing teeth on the lower part of my mouth here. But hopefully that will be corrected in time with maybe a couple of implants and bridge work. When I smile, you can't tell. And when I'm on stage, I can still articulate, I can still sing, I can still chew, I can eat.
Yeah.
I'm enjoying life, and I am embracing life, not only with my singing, but just being here and just being able to tell my story, and to hopefully inspire other people who, like I said, are going through rough times like illness and debilitation, and that's what I learned, that if you have a passion in your life,
I agree.
Follow that passion, and that will get you through the rough times. And it's gotten me through the rough times. I cannot tell you. And it's like when's the next show coming up? When's my next show? I always look forward to the next show.
And speaking of the next show,
yes,
we can give the audience a little preview of your Richard Rodgers show, which you will be reprise. I can't even tell you right now. You were bringing back to the Metropolitan Room, and that will be in August. But this one is your first performance of the Richard Rodgers show.
This was the second performance.
The second
performance.
Okay, so we're going to see a roll-in. I think it's 3 songs, right?
Greet you with a song in my heart.
How was that?
I behold your adorable face, just a song at the start, but it soon is a hymn to your grace. When the music swells, I'm touching your hand. It tells that you're standing are alive with the sound of music. I know I will hear what I've heard before. My heart will be blessed with the sound of music, and I'll sing once more. At the sound of your voice, heaven opens its portals to me. Can't I help but rejoice that a song such as ours came to be? But I always knew I would live right through with a song in my heart for you. With the sound of his music for you. I've never met you, yet never doubt, dear, I can't forget you. I thought you out, dear. I know your profile and I know the way you kiss. Just the thing I miss on a night like this. Isn't it romantic? Music in the night, a dream that can be heard. Isn't it romantic? Moving shadows right, the oldest magic word. I hear the breezes playing in the trees above, while all the world is saying you were meant for love. Isn't it romantic? Merely to be young on such a night as this. Isn't it romantic? Every note that's sung is like a lover's kiss. Sweet symbols in the moonlight. Do you mean that I will fall in love perchance? Isn't it romance? I used to be a grumpy, rabbit old lad. Look at your beamish boy now. I used to be so jumpy, silly and sad. What is simply joy now? Life was a canyon too dark to view, till a companion was found like you. Thou swell, thou witty, thou sweet, thou grand, wouldst kiss me pretty, wouldst hold my hand. Both thine eyes are cute too, what they do to me. Hear me holler, I choose a sweet Lollapalooza in thee. I feel so rich in a hut for two, two rooms and kitchen I'm sure would do. Give me just a plot of not a lot of land, and I feel at home with you. You always sit on the knees that you sit on. That's why I feel at home with you. I've a sensible, comprehensible, great respect for you. There's a dash in it of a passionate, tender feeling too. You are a part of me, something that's giving me reason for living. That's why I feel at home with you. I feel so rich in a hut for two, just two rooms and kitchen, I'm sure would do. Give me just a plot of not a lot of land, and I feel at home, I feel at home. Thou swell, thou witty, thou brave.
That was great, Richard. That was Richard Holbrook performing at the Metropolitan Room, his Richard Rodgers show, which he will be performing again August 26th. And
well, it's going to be
looking forward to seeing that show. But and you wanted to tell us a little background about Richard Rodgers, though.
Yes.
How you met his daughter.
Yes, I got to know his daughter last year. I had no idea how ill she was, but she was a very sweet lady. We got to be phone friends, and she was the first conversation I had with her. I kept calling her Mrs. Emery because that's her married name. Her name is Linda Rodgers Emery. Mm-hmm. And she said, by the end of the conversation, she said, I think it's about time you started calling me Linda. And she said, I'm so glad you're doing a show on that pompous composer. And so she was very thrilled I was doing it.
Yeah.
And she was going to come with her son, Peter Melnick. But she had broken her hip, and you know, her health went downhill. And so she did not make the show in October, and she died less than a month later in November of 2015. She had just celebrated her 80th birthday, but what a lovely lady she was. The thing about Richard Rodgers is that I talked to you about this before.
Yeah.
His life was a strange dichotomy in the fact that even though he wrote inspiring, uplifting, and optimistic songs, in his private life, he was a very troubled man and had his own personal demons. And he was not easy to get along with, but his music was just it was so inspiring. And it continues to inspire and transcend generations of all ages to this day.
Isn't it amazing how someone that can come out of someone and they're so unhappy?
And his songs seem as fresh as they fresh now as they were
like
when they were first written.
Yeah,
very upbeat and very positive and
positive
very positive
messages.
Messages, yes.
Right.
Like climb every mountain and you know.
Maybe that was his wish to be like that or to attain that.
Yeah.
Climb every mountain.
Yeah. According to his daughter Mary, who is a very wonderful composer in her own right, she passed away 2 years ago, he had many, many phobias. He had phobias about heights, about being on planes. She said about heights, she said, I had no idea how my mother got him on the 17th floor of the Pierre Hotel. So, but, you know, with all of his tribulations and trials, he was able to rise above them and to create such wonderful pieces of music. I mean, he was once asked what his proudest achievement on Broadway was. It was Carousel. Carousel.
Wow.
And the Soliloquy,
yes.
Which he wrote, is one of the most dazzling and brilliant pieces he ever wrote.
I love that so much.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
I mean, that is, and I get to sing that.
There are just such wonderful things when you think of it. Well, that song alone.
Yeah. It's like an aria.
Yeah. And the whole story of how a father feels. If it's a girl, Bill, you know, it's wonderful.
I fell in love with that score when I was 18, and my school was about to do that, and I knew
you had to have it.
Well, I knew I was never going to be cast as Billy Bigelow,
yeah.
But I said one day I'm going to sing that song, and I'm doing it.
So great about cabaret.
Yeah.
You know, there are certain roles you're not going to get.
Yeah.
I mean, I've been there myself, and I just say, well, I'll do it in one a cabaret show. And I'll get to sing that song.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And I'm working with such wonderful musicians. I've got Tom Nelson, who's my musical director and pianist. I've got Tom Kirschmer on bass, Peter Grant on drums. And my director is Academy Award winning documentary filmmaker and veteran cabaret and Broadway performer, Richard Barkley.
And you've been with all of them for a number of years.
Yeah, I've been with Tom for 16 years. I've been with Dick for about 13 years. And it's a winning combination. It really is a wonderful combination. And so I'm doing this on Friday, August 26th at 7 p.m. at the Metropolitan Room, which is located at 34 West 22nd Street between 5th and 6th Avenue in Manhattan in the Flatiron District. And if anybody wants to order tickets, they can go to www.metropolitanroom.com.
Okay, we've got it up on the screen.
Or they, if they want to call and make a reservation, the phone number is 212-206-0440. And they can call that number Monday through Sunday after 12 o'clock noon.
Okay, again, that's August 26th, right there in big letters at 7 p.m.
7 p.m., yeah. And it's a Friday night, and I'm looking forward to seeing as many people there as possible. I hope people do come, and I'd love to see you there if you can make it.
Yes, I will be there.
Thank you.
And your Richard Rodgers show is your latest and greatest, and you certainly intend to
continue
to do it,
continue. I would like to continue.
I know you did that with your previous
Burton Lane
as well.
Yeah, it's just something about singing the songs of the composers who wrote the Great American Songbook. They're just timeless. They're timeless, and they still have a life in them. They still have a life and a message, and a positive one at that. Especially Richard Rodgers.
Especially Richard Rodgers. When you really, this is the thing. I love lyrics. You don't. Sometimes you don't hear them in some songs, but usually, these composers, you hear the songs and the story. They all tell stories.
Yeah.
All these wonderful songs.
And do you know that with Hammerstein, with Larry Hart, the music came first, then the lyrics. With Hammerstein, it was the exact opposite.
You know what I meant? You know. There was someone on TV talking about that recently, where they said too that they write the music first, and it's so funny. I almost think that the lyrics should. I don't know why I think the lyrics should come first, but then again, it depends on what you do.
Exactly.
If you're sitting at the piano and composing beautiful music, you go, "Well, I want some lyrics to this." So it depends on what side you're on.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, I'm not exactly.
Yeah.
You know. A composer, but you can write some lyrics, so that's why probably I see it that way.
Yeah.
But it all depends. A lot of so with most of his collaborators,
he wrote the music second, but with Larry Hart he wrote the music first. So
they switched it around for Larry Hart.
But it worked.
That's interesting. You certainly always do some great research on your shows and. We're coming to the end of this show, Richard, but I'm so glad to have had you back again.
Thank you so much, darling.
I know, I know you're happy to be performing again.
Yes, I am. I'm happy to see you and to be alive.
Your followers are thrilled that you're performing again as well. And anytime, come on back and see us.
I will.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
And I thank you all for watching. I think we have maybe a couple of minutes, but that's it. Thank you for watching. See you next time. Bye for now.